Happy Resurrection Day to everyone. Good to see you. If you have your bulletin, I want to encourage you to get out your sermon notes this morning. And as always, I always encourage you just to jot down, take notes. As the Lord gives you something, it's always worth jotting it down. My tradition here, which goes back many years, I always wear a pair of carpenter pants on Easter and on Christmas. I always think about the Lord Jesus when he came to this earth. He could have come as anything, but he came as a simple carpenter. He came to build a bridge between earth and heaven. And today we're here to celebrate that incredible story, the story of Easter. I want to say a special thanks to Eric Weidman. He put the tomb together for us. He does a great job. I really appreciate his heart, his willingness to do that. And so this morning we want to share the Easter story. And on your notes, there's both sides look the same. One will have God's story, the other has man's story. But we want to start with God's story. So if you're on that side, and if you have a pen, you can just kind of fill in the as we go along, do some drawing. You know, the cross, I believe Easter always begins at Calvary. Even though we think of the empty tomb, and certainly that is a great part of Easter, but you know, without the cross, there would be no tomb. Because resurrection always speaks of the physical body. So before there can be a resurrection, there has to be a death. And so I want us just to kind of think back and look at the cross this morning, because the cross, as the Bible says, is foolishness to those who are perishing, but the message of the cross is the power of God for us who are being saved. And so this morning, I want to tie the Easter message in with the cross. And so I want us to kind of think about the cross this morning. I want us to, first of all, think about the horizontal part of the cross. And if you can, I want you to imagine an arrow. And I'm going to put an arrow up here pointing this way. And if you could draw a line on your paper all the way off to the edge, I just want to remind you that God has always been here. From the very, very beginning, God's existence has always been here. And then if we were to take that line and just go straight across, we're reminded that God will always be here as well. And the Bible says it in many different ways. The Bible says he is the first and the last, the beginning and the end, the Alpha, the Omega. He is from everlasting to everlasting. And so I just want to remind you, unlike us who have a beginning, God has always been here, will always be here. And so the message of Easter begins by understanding that God is eternal. Again, God has always existed, will always exist. But the Bible says in the fullness of time, and so I've got a dot up there, in the fullness of time, God chose to step down from his eternal glory state. He stepped down to this earth and took on an earth suit. And what a beautiful thing every year as we celebrate Christmas, the fact that God loved us enough that he was willing to leave his home in glory, step down to this earth, and literally, ultimately, go to Calvary, because you and I would have been forever separated from God. But again, in the fullness of time, and I love how the Bible says it so beautifully in the book of Matthew, they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is translated God with us. When Jesus walked this earth, it was eternal God who took on an earth suit. I love how Paul says it in Colossians 1, that he is the visible form of the invisible God. I love how John says it in the Gospel of John, the first chapter. It says, in the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. But then he says in verse 14 there of John 1, that the Word became flesh. That somehow the miracle that God loved us so much that he was willing to come down and take on human form and to die in our place so that we would not forever be separated from himself. And so I'll put down the black arrow here, just reminding us that God's love enabled him to come down. And not only did he come down and walk on this earth, which is as miraculous of itself, But the Bible says that he actually went further down, that he was willing to die and be buried. And so I have a picture here of the tomb. I love this picture, and I love how the cross, there's kind of a shadow of the cross over the empty tomb. That to me reminds me of the Easter story. There is the empty tomb, but again, the cross is so vitally important to know that he died in our place. The Bible says he was buried according to Scripture, and that he rose the third day. And so we're here this morning to celebrate the resurrection. We're here to celebrate that empty tomb. And so he not only was willing to go down, but the Bible says that third day he rose again. And so I want to put a yellow arrow here to remind us that he not only came down and died for us, but the third day he rose again. And that's the celebration of the Easter story. And so in a very beautiful, very simple way, the cross tells the story of God's love. It tells a very simple gospel story that God has always existed, will always exist, but yet in the fullness of time, he loved us enough to be willing to come down to live and to die for us. And then the third day, he rose from the grave. That's the celebration of God's story, the celebration of God's love for us. And I just want to remind you today how special you are to God, that he loved you enough. And I believe the Bible teaches if you were the only one that would have gone astray, that he would be willing to leave his home in glory, come down to this earth, and to seek and to save, even if just one sheep had gone astray. That's the beautiful story of God's love. On the other side of that, man's story. And I want to use the same cross to think about our story and what part we play in this gospel. And so unlike God, God who has always been here, will always be here, that's not true, obviously, of us. So I'm going to take this arrow down because we have not always existed. But for man, there comes a time that we too, obviously, we are born. So you're here. So God had a plan and a purpose for your life. I love how it says in Psalms 139, let's just read together part of that verse. I am fearfully and wonderfully made. You know, God, there are no accidents. You know, in our family, I was the fourth of four children. And my parents were only planning on having three children. They were done after my brother. I guess my brother gave them fits. I don't know. But they said, we're done having kids. But 20 months after my brother was born, I was born. And even though my sisters told me later, I have twin sisters who are 9 years older than me, my sisters told me, you're an accident. You weren't supposed to be here. But even though it wasn't originally in my parents' plan, I do believe it was in God's plan. And I just want to say to you, there are no accidents. You are a gift from God, and God created you. And so I believe, I love how Psalms 139 talks about how beautifully we're made in our mother's womb. I believe life begins at conception. I believe God forms and creates us inside of our mother's womb, a very beautiful, beautiful picture of life. And so unlike God, obviously, we have not always been here, but there comes a time. For me, it was October 10th, 1956, when God allowed me to come into this world. And again, even though I wasn't a part of my parents' original plan, I'm thankful my parents loved me. I'm thankful that I had godly parents. I'm really thankful that my parents were patient with me. And so anyway, we're here to celebrate. And so one day the Bible says, not only are we all here, obviously, but we too have an appointed time to die. You know, that's something we don't think about, we don't like to talk about, but the reality is one day, unless the Lord comes back, all of us are going to go down. We're all going to face physical death. The Bible says, again, we have an appointed time to die. I don't know when that is, but I do want to say this. I am thankful that we're not on earth forever. that God has a better plan. But even though we're all a part of God's plan, again, the reality is one day we're all going to face death. Now, sometimes there were people in the Bible that seemed to defy that law. There was people in the Bible that seemed like they were the Energizer bunnies and they were never going to die. I think about Adam that lived to be 930, Noah that lived to be 950, and then there was Methuselah, 969 years. It seemed like he was going to escape death, but yet death came. I think about Hezekiah that was given a 15-year extension, and even though God gave him another 15 years, he too had to die. I think about Lazarus, who had to die twice. He died once and Jesus called him back from the grave, but then he had to die again. Because again, the Bible says we each have an appointed time. And that's why the resurrection is so important. Because one day we're all going to face what we call death. And again, when I say death, I want to be real clear. When a person dies, they continue to exist, but their spirit and their body separate. And so when the Bible refers to a believer's death, I love how it refers to the body as just being asleep. A very beautiful picture that that body is just asleep. One day it's going to be resurrected and be reunited to our spirit. But when you die, your spirit, if you're a believer, your spirit immediately goes to be with the Lord. That's why Paul said to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And so you're going to live forever. I mean, you're going to live forever. And one day there's going to be a resurrected and this body will come back from the grave. And so I've got a tombstone here. And so I'm going to chisel my name on here. One day you may be walking through a cemetery and read my name on a tombstone. But I want you to know that I'll still be alive. I'll be in the presence of God. And what you're looking at is the place over my earth suit. All right. But one day that earth suit is going to come up. Every time I have the privilege of doing a funeral and standing at the graveside and think about those committal words as we commit that body to the grave, we're reminded that one day all of those bodies and all of the cemeteries are going to come up out of that grave because of Jesus' victory over the grave. The resurrection is one of the most powerful doctrines in the Bible. One of the most important messages in God's word is the resurrection. And if I could chisel something on the other side of my tombstone, I would put construction complete. How many of you know that as long as you're in this earth suit, you are a work in progress, right? How many of you know you don't have it all together? How many of your spouses would say you don't have it all together, right? In case you're not sure, somebody says, I'm not sure if I have it all together, ask your children, all right? They can usually tell you. They're usually really, really honest. And so as long as we're in the earth suit, we're a work in progress. But when we're done, and one day when you see me lying in a casket, I hope there's a sign on it that says, construction complete, thank you for your patience. How many of you know you got to be patient because God isn't finished with us yet? But one day, again, we're all going to face death. That's a reality. And if we understand that, obviously how important eternal life is, it becomes really, really important when you understand we're all going to face death. But one day, the Bible says there's going to be a resurrection for all of us. We're either going to be resurrected to life or we're going to be resurrected to death. We're still going to be alive, exist. We're either going to be with God or we're going to be separated from God. But everyone is going to live forever. You're going to exist forever. You say, what does an eternal person look like? Turn to your right and then turn to your left. That's what an eternal person looks like. Looks like me and you. Isn't it kind of strange to think 100 years from this morning, we're all going to be alive? 1,000 years from this morning, we're all going to be alive. Now, at some point, we're going to get a resurrection, and my earth suit will change and be reunited to my spirit, but we're going to live forever. And so we're going to be resurrected. Verse in John 5, we actually looked at it last week, but remember when Jesus said, all those who are in the grave will hear my voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life, those who have done evil to the resurrection of condemnation, but everyone will be resurrected. And then the Bible says that we're going to live forever. Jesus said, whoever believes in him shall have everlasting life. And so unlike God, we're not always here, but like God, we are, if we were to draw this line out this way, we're going to live forever. And so you're no accident. I believe that God had a plan and a purpose for your life. But one day, and I think you ought to take care of yourself. How many of you think you ought to eat good, exercise, all those things, eat tree bark, whatever it is. But you know, one day this earth suit is going to die. But again, the good news, we're all going to get a resurrected body, a body that's like Jesus. And the Bible teaches, if we were to draw a line out this way, that we're going to live forever. That's what the Bible calls everlasting or eternal life, all right? So let's look at it just a little bit closer. I want you to imagine the grave is open, and we're all going to be resurrected, and we're going to spend eternity one of two places. We're either going to spend an eternity with the Lord in his presence, or we're going to be separated from God, which the Bible refers to as the second death. It doesn't mean you're not existing. It just means you're separated from God. So let's first of all look at eternal life. And the Greek word for life is zoe. Everybody say zoe. That's the Greek word. It's used 134 times. And so in John 3:16, let's read it together. And when we get to life, put the word zoe in there because that's the Greek word that's used. Let's read together. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting zoe. And so again, the God kind of life, there's a word in the Bible that talks about physical life. There's a word that talks about mental life. But then there's that eternal life. It's that life that God gives that we're going to live forever. And by the way, eternal life doesn't begin when you die. How many of you know that? Eternal life begins when you invite Jesus Christ into your life. When you invite Jesus into your life, I believe we begin to experience that God kind of life. And so we're going to have an option to either live forever with God. The other option is death. We're going to be forever separated from God, which we looked at last week in the book of Revelation. Anyone not found written in the book of life is ultimately cast into the lake of fire. Well, they will exist forever and ever separated from God. And so as we celebrate resurrection, it's really a reminder of the incredible hope we have. Because this life is temporary. This life is just a blink. The James says, you know, it's like a vapor that appears for a short time and then vanishes away. How crazy would it be for us to wrap all of our hope in this world and not understand that the most important thing is where we go when we depart this world? Let me remind you, how many of you have ever seen a headstone that said this? Here lies an atheist all dressed up and no place to go. Have you ever heard of that? So I found this picture. I don't know if that's actually somebody under there or not, but I took a picture of it. Here lies an atheist all dressed up and no place to go, but I'm gonna tell you, he will rise. If somebody truly has rejected God, he too will be resurrected. He too will stand before God. The reality is that all of us will stand before God. And we're either going to stand based on what Christ has done for us and be welcomed into his presence, or we're going to stand before God based on our performance and what we believe and will ultimately be rejected. But I just want to tell you, and even though I see that on the headstone, I think it's kind of funny, the reality is he will be resurrected because the Bible says we all will be resurrected. And so Paul says this in 1 Corinthians 15. I like how the Amplified Bible says it. You say, is the resurrection that important? Yeah, it's really important. As a matter of fact, the Bible says without a resurrection, all of this is in vain. Our preaching is in vain. Your faith is in vain. It's all dependent on the resurrection. And so I'm going to read the yellow, and you all read the white. And so let's read it together. I'll read the yellow. You all join in on the white. All right. This is out of the Amplified Bible, and it's a part of this passage. It's not the entire passage. But join in on the white. If Christ has not been raised, then our preaching is in vain. And your faith is also vain. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless and powerless. You are still in your sins. So the resurrection was so important because, again, it gives us that hope in the future. I love how Lee Strobel in The Case for Christ said this: every single shred of evidence for the resurrection of Jesus Christ is also evidence for my eventual resurrection. I just want to tell you again, you're going to live forever. And these old earth suits, even though they wear out, one day they're going to be resurrected because of Christ's victory over the grave. We are going to live forever. How important is the resurrection story? Josh McDowell, who set out to prove the Bible wrong and prove it to be a hoax, he discovered that all of the evidence weighed in favor of the Bible being true. And he said this: after more than 700 hours of studying this subject and thoroughly investigating its foundation, I have come to the conclusion that the resurrection of Jesus Christ is one of the most wicked, vicious, heartless hoaxes ever forced on the minds of men, or it is the most fantastic fact of history. I want to tell you, it's incredible as we celebrate the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said in John 11:25, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. I just want to tell you there's hope. I just want to tell you that God loved us so much that he was willing to come down to die on the cross, be buried and rise again to give us all hope that there is something beyond this world. And I'm so glad that there is. Last year, I went down to Jefferson Barracks and just walked through the cemetery. One of the most emotional things I've ever done. I've been there many times for funerals, but this time I just went and just kind of walked around and just spent some time walking through the rows and rows and rows of tombstones. Going back, people who had died a long time ago, some of the tombstones were even of a children. I think one was even a child, one day old. That was very heart-gripping to see a tombstone that had the name, date of birth, and the date of death was one day apart. You know, the reality is we don't know how long God is giving us, but we do know that we're going to live forever. We know that there's going to be a resurrection. And ultimately, one day, as I walk through a cemetery like this and just kind of think about the resurrection. Again, Jesus' words in John 5, one day all those who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth. There's ultimately going to be a resurrection of all of these bodies that are in the grave. Some are going to be resurrected to life, Zoe. Some will be resurrected to death. But every single person will be resurrected. And so I just want to remind you, as you have Easter, and there's a lot of great things about Easter. I love getting with family. I love the food. I love the desserts. I love the travel. But you know, in all of it, I hope you always remember the real meaning of Easter, that God loved us so much and he didn't want us to forever be separated, that he was willing to leave his home in glory and come down. And again, the simple gospel, as Paul lays it out in 1 Corinthians 15, that Christ died for our sins according to the scripture, that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day. That's the celebration of Easter. I hope someday when we stand before God, I hope when we have that reunion in the sky, I hope we look around and we see every face that's here today at that reunion. Not because you were a member of a particular church or a denomination, but because you trusted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You know, when we get to heaven, it's not about a church, it's not about a denomination. But Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. And so I want to ask you, as we close, the most important thing I could ask you. Do you know without a shadow of a doubt which way you're going to go when you die? Because it's here we have to make that decision. How many of you hate making decisions? I hate decisions. I mean, you know, sometimes it takes us 30 minutes to decide where we're going to eat. They need to name a restaurant. I don't care. They would get a lot of business, right? Because someone's like, where do you want to eat? I don't care. Let's go there. And somebody says, I just don't want to decide. Many of you came today, maybe for family, for other reasons. Probably the last thing most of you thought is that you were going to have to make a decision today. But all of us decide. And if we don't decide for God, we decide against God. Let's pray together. I want to pray just a simple prayer. If you're here today and you feel the Holy Spirit tugging at your heart, maybe today, for the first time in your life, you would just open up your heart and receive Christ. Would you pray this simple prayer from your heart to His? Dear Jesus, I thank you for loving me. I thank you for creating me. I realize how much you love me, that you died on the cross for my sin. I ask you to forgive me. And right now, I open up the door of my heart. I invite you into my life as Lord and Savior. From this day forward, my life belongs to you. I hope this morning, if you prayed that prayer for the first time, I hope that you'll tell somebody before you leave or find me after the service and just say, I prayed that prayer. It's the most important decision you can ever make. It's an eternal decision. The Bible says, whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. I hope today is a great Easter. I hope it's a good time with family and friends. But most of all, I hope you have that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what really counts throughout all eternity. Let's stand together as we have just a moment of invitation. As we have just a moment of quiet music, if you're here today and you want to come out, and if there's something that you need to share, if you want to just slip out and come, say, I prayed that prayer, or you want someone to pray with you or pray for you, we would love to do that. If you're here this morning as a Christian, I hope you'll take a moment and just thank God for His incredible love for you. And I hope you all realize that you're not an accident, that you're somebody very special, that God loves you so much. So let's take a moment and just love on Jesus as He loves on us. If you need to come, you slip out and come, or if you need to go to somebody, you do that. Before we have our final closing song, I want us just to do a Jesus cheer. We didn't do it in the early service, but I just feel like we should do it. Yeah, I hope we just kind of shake the rafters. You know, there's something very powerful about the name of Jesus. The Bible says one day every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus is Lord. And so the only way I know to do it, the way we used to do it in school, I say, give me a J, and you all go,
J.
Half of you remember high school, the other half has been a while, all right? So you gotta fist pump too, all right? Not out or this way, but up. Always go up, all right? And so I want you to give me your best resurrection Jesus cheer. All right? There is something powerful about the name. And so we just want to shout the name of Jesus. All right, here we go. Give me a J.
J.
Give me an E.
E.
Give me an S.
S.
Give me a U.
U.
Give me an S.
S.
What's the spell?
Jesus.
Who's King of Kings?
Jesus.
Who's Lord of Lords?
Jesus.
Who's worthy of all praise?
Jesus.
Who's coming back one day?
Jesus.
God bless you. Remember that name.